Welcome to another episode of Wine Guide TV with your host Dan Sims and my good friend Mr. Ben Edwards. Today, even though it's getting into this cooler winter months, we're going to look at some Posh barbecue plonk. Why not?
Why not indeed? Well, you know, it's an Australian tradition and we barbecue all year round.
It is, and particularly that I've got a really small kitchen in my place and I have to cook with a barbecue despite the fact that it's going to be winter. I love it.
You thought this was fairly appropriate.
Fairly appropriate. No. But also, as a little prelude to this, coming up nationally is the Good Food and Wine Show, in which we will be presenting a whole range of tasting and events in the Riedel Decanter Bar.
They're in all the nationals capitals.
They are.
State capitals, which is great.
And we'll be doing an event very much like this. So if you get a chance, come along.
Yeah, terrific. So Kate, what we're going to do is obviously we're going to have a little progression of flavour. These are just really good examples of wines that are interesting.
Yes.
First and foremost, and not particularly expensive,
no?
And good drinks, and probably best enjoyed in the full flush of youth.
Absolutely, and I think, you know, the highlight of many of these wines is their accessibility and drinkability, and we talk about this whole drinkability scale. These would all be very high. Now, to kick off, Vermentino. Vermentino. Traditionally coming from Italy, there's a number of producers in Australia now making this particular grape variety. These guys, ducks in a row, apart from the fact that they're really lovely people and they've got a very fancy label. The wine, the Vermentino, is really lovely and fresh and dry. 2010, nice and crisp, little hint of straw. Just really lovely, easy drinking.
And just a little bit of spice, just to add a bit of interest. And, you know, if you're thinking you're doing a little bit of cured salmon or something like that.
Oh, hang on, I know. Sardines.
Ooh,
grilled sardines. Vermentino and sardines. Keep an eye out for those. They're rather obsessed about sardines, these people.
That's very good. Well, I like a good sardine myself, Dan. Okay, we're going to move. Again, we've got another interesting grape variety. Grüner Veltliner is the grape variety. It's the origins of Austria, not Australia, and this is coming from the Canberra district. Now, this is from a producer, Lark Hill, fully sick, 120% biodynamic. Now, I just mentioned the biodynamics because, you know, it's a very important aspect to what they do. Grüner Veltliner has a variety, I think kind of Riesling, but with a lot more flesh, and you get all those lovely high notes of lemon, a little bit of apple, but then this kind of almost like white pepper character
as well. Yeah, it is. It's a lovely lifted, and also that I love that mix between that freshness and that texture. So again, sort of that textural element balancing out with that acidity makes it a really good wine to drink, not just on its own, but also with some food as well, which makes it really interesting. And that's the first release. In fact, is that the first commercial release, of Grüner Veltliner in Australia, which is pretty impressive.
We can all research that. Google machine.
Good.
But Chris Carpenter is a very talented young man. You can find him on Twitter even.
Even so. Now, moving on to Pinot Noir. Obviously, we love Pinot Noir. We're obsessed by the stuff. This particular wine did incredibly well in one of our Pinot tastings for Pinot Unearthed in the Martin Brothers, the Palliser Pincaro. It actually blew us away. We were incredibly surprised when we did the unveil because we looked at it all unmasked. The quality level and of these wines are just...
Well, and the thing about this particular wine is it's a second label, if you like. It's a sort of step down from their estate wine. Yet, as an early release young wine, it is so thoroughly delicious. It looks like Marlborough, you know, it's got the weight and the depth and the power, but it's just that little bit lighter, and so it just makes it a bit more accessible. Now, we gave it 95. In fact, I think we even gave it 96 points straight off the bat. And at the price, it can get around sort of $20 to $25, depending on where you're buying it. It's an absolute bargain. I have drunk more than my fair share of that
wine. Would you say a wine to enjoy, but not necessarily in moderation?
You just said it for me. Okay, so a perennial favourite of mine, it goes back a long way to the dim dark days back in the 80s when I started in the wine industry. But Gigal Cote de Rhone is an absolute staple of many, many people. And as a barbecue wine, it sort of treads that beautiful line between being posh and also just being a damn good drink.
Absolutely. And again, Cote de Rhone, we talk, you know, so much about luncheon wines being, you know, so we love that sort of Chablis or crisp Chardonnay. Cote de Rhone being, again, another one of those wines. It sits in that medium-bodied spectrum that's got wonderful fruit character, a little bit of savouriness, and can, you know, handle those little bit of charred meat element, but still be able to drink it and enjoy it. And that, so I mean...
It's the Southern Rhone Valley in France. It's Grenache, Shiraz, Mourvèdre. It's almost like it's got fresh blackberries crushed into this, but then underneath it, it's got this lovely sort of element of sage and rosemary, thyme, all those sort of hard herbs that you sort of associate with the Provençal Garrigue.
It is, and it's got its essence-y. It's almost like binding into that sort of, you know, purple and pastel.
And that's like 5 years old, and it's still as fresh as a daisy. It was a good cork, too.
Good cork.
Thank the cork gods. Right, moving along to Argentina, Dan.
Malbec. Well, when we're thinking about barbecues, you can't really go past Malbec, especially from Argentina. Mm. I mean, they do barbecues probably almost as good as we do. We can't, you know, we say that. But, you know, after visiting Mendoza, it's a bit cool, isn't it? But
I'm waiting for the hate mail.
Yeah, already. Exactly. But when we visited Mendoza, went to Mendoza early last year, it was, I mean, the food, having charred meat and drinking Malbec, it just made complete sense, and it was super. Felipe Rutini, this is their trumpeter wine. With Malbec, you're starting to see some more of that dark fruit, again, a little bit more spice to
They're
it.
Really fragrant, really lifted. You know,
very
perfumed. You pick them up and the perfume just jumps out of the glass, and you just go, ooh, I really want to drink that.
And also what I love about, too, you know, with Malbec is you've got that tannin, but it's also got really lovely acidity. So it becomes refreshing. Not only you get that tannin to cut through with some charred bit of meat,
grass-fed preferably,
that'll just, actually, it's still really, really refreshing. I really love the wine, and the people are lovely, and it's a great visit.
It is. So if you're in Mendoza, you should go to Felipe Rutini. I think that's what Dan was trying to say. The point of all of this, points-wise, 88 points for Ducks in a Row, maybe even a tad more. We're looking at about 90 points for that Larkhill, a great first-up effort for Groeneveld, 95/96 for Pencaro, about 90 points for the Cote de Rhone, could even, you know, moving into 91, and a lovely, little, delicious little 90 gluggable Felipe Rutini Malbec. Their trumpet of wine.
Absolutely. So next time you go to a barbecue, have a bit of a think about what you're going to bring and probably have a discover of some of these other different varietals. Worth it.
You know, mix it up a bit.
Have some fun.
That's what it's all about at poshbarbecueplonk.com.
I'll see you next week.